Marla, COP26 in full effect. What does it hope to achieve? What can be achieved?
Well, that's a really great question, Larysa. What COP26 does is it gives the world leaders and the countries a chance to actually come together and work together as a larger group instead of just working bilaterally or trilaterally on different efforts of things. It's a chance for everybody to come together, for smaller nations to be heard, for larger nations to try to up what they're doing. It really becomes that chance for everybody to get their voices at the table at the same time and make pledges globally that are a lot harder to enact two and three at a time.
Canada and countries around the world have set targets of net zero by 2050. How doable is this?
Well, I'll sort of back up just a little bit to talk about what these goals are. The entire purpose of COP is really to talk about various environmental concerns, and particularly the ones that are leading towards climate change. But it's not just a net zero target as one thing. There's a lot of little bits and pieces to what that means. So, for example, there is a global deforestation pact that is being signed, and it is bringing in China, and it's bringing in Russia, and it's bringing in Brazil, and some of the countries that are having the largest deforestation. Deforestation is contributing something like 25% of emissions. And so deforestation is one important piece to focus on. Another important piece is methane reduction. So that's also something where a pact is being put into place. So there's a lot of different sub-efforts that all connect on this road down which COP26 is walking.
What happens when everyone is not on board? China has set its own net zero targets of 2060. They have suggested that they will use coal as fuel. How does that change the course of action?
Yeah, it certainly makes it a lot harder, that's for sure. And China has decided not to show up to, for example, the global methane pledge. But as I mentioned, they are signing the deforestation pledge. So they really are picking and choosing. We've seen this from other countries before. President Trump had pulled the United States out of the Paris agreements. Now President Biden has shown up at COP26. So there can be changes in the approaches of a single country over time. What something like COP26 does is certainly lays out the opportunity and puts on the pressure onto global leaders to sign on to hopefully all the bits and pieces. It may be the case that even if China is not signing on to methane right now, that it chooses to do so in the future as things start to change.
Are countries, including Canada, in a position to move away from oil and gas?
In the short term, not possible. Not just for us, but really not for anybody, or hardly any countries whatsoever. It may be a goal that a lot of countries are aspiring to, but at the same time, there's a lot of practicalities. We simply don't have the ability to flip the switch and get off oil and gas. And this is something that we've seen in recent weeks and months globally with huge costs in energy just spiking through the roof in some places due to supply and demand issues. There's not always enough supply available. If we were to shut down oil and gas tomorrow, we would all freeze in the dark, as the saying goes, because we simply don't have the infrastructure in place right now to be able to deliver other sources of energy, not wind and solar, not nuclear, not fully gas. So we are phasing out oil and gas for various reasons, but it's going to still be around for decades to come.
The reality on the ground is that Europe is dealing with its own challenges and its own energy crisis.
It is, and Europe has a couple of different challenges going on. On the one hand, natural gas prices have risen by something like 5 times and made it extremely expensive. And now coal plants are being brought back online in Europe because something has to fill that space. And a lot of producers are going back to putting coal into the mix. I don't think it's an outcome that anybody would have seen. What the UK is experiencing with gasoline prices or petrol prices is a little bit different. They are seeing a supply problem because of Brexit, basically. They now just don't have enough truck drivers anymore because a lot of their truck drivers were from Europe. They've decided to go back home, not welcome in the UK anymore. And so they're not getting the deliveries of gasoline that they would like. So it's not so much in what's happening in the UK about climate change efforts as it has been about politics and Brexit.
Marla, talk to us about the successes and failures of global climate agreements. We've seen the Kyoto Protocol, the Paris Agreement. How successful have these agreements been in the past?
It's a really good point. There have been a number of declarations, Kyoto, Rio, Paris, and we keep failing to meet them. They are aspirational, that's for sure. But at the same time, having a set target in place, I think, does drive some action. As we were talking about earlier, under this overarching ambition, there are smaller pieces that have been developed. So one of the things that Canada recently signed was this global methane pledge. The idea being that all the countries that signed on, and there are a couple dozen, would reduce methane, which is one of the most short-term and most potent greenhouse gases. It would be reduced by 30% by 2030 compared to the year 2020 as a baseline. We're already well on our way in many cases. Alberta, for example, already had in place a 45% by 2030 reduction target. So the baseline year is different, but nonetheless, these are aligned and these are directions in which our entire country is moving the same way. I haven't done the calculations to try to figure out how the Alberta pledge, and the Saskatchewan has a similar one, how that matches up to what the federal government has signed on to. But it is moving in the same direction. So at least on methane, there looks to be a very good chance of actually meeting what the challenge is. And there's also an opportunity for Canada in this. We are one of the global leaders in methane reduction technologies. And this comes out of the stringency of the regulations that we've had so far. You don't get the same thing in the States, for example. So there is an opportunity for those who understand how to reduce methane to now sell this knowledge, this service, this expertise to other parts of the world that have signed on to the pledge and that are going to need to do something to reduce.
Global economies dealing with inflation and supply chain issues. Does this change things for countries that have earmarked monies for climate change?
I don't know if they're going to be rolling back funding, but what it reminds me of, Larysa, is a little bit about that saying about it's never a good time to have a baby. There's always something. In that sense, it's probably also never, if you're waiting for the perfect conditions under which to introduce new stretch targets, new challenges, you're going to be waiting forever.